I was worried for a minute. There were only about four or five of us here. Then we had a great group come in. Time changed. Everybody's happy. Got to sleep. I got to sleep 10 hours last night. I'm just so excited. I may just continue this service on to 12:30 or so. No, won't do that. We welcome all of you to our service of worship. Those of you that are visiting with us, we're glad to have you here. It's on. I do hate technology. I'm going on. Can you hear me in the house? If you can hear me, then they'll figure it out. Let's turn to the announcements on the back of the bulletin real quick. They'll get it figured out or not. Is it working now, Grace? Okay. I see all kind of green lights flashing, so it must be. Okay, third Sunday potluck is coming up. I'll have my list next week by the door. We have a special guest here that's coming from the regional office. We need plenty of food, so I may even go back to making my green bean casserole, although there were times that it was never too much of it eaten. I don't know if I didn't do it right or what happened to it. So that we have plenty that day, he'll be here. This is a great thing. I'll take a second to mention that the State Office of the Christian Church, since our new regional minister, Don Gillette, has come into office a couple of years ago, he has tried, rather than the state office, in my opinion, being reactive to problems in churches, they're being proactive, not to problems, but all of the ministers on the staff are going out and visiting in various churches each Sunday all over the state, which I think is great because it gives we say the state office, and we say, well, what's that? And they say, oh, well, that's who sends us our ministers. Well, they want to do more and be ready for us if we need anything. So Josh and his three kids are going to be here on that Sunday. You can read the rest of this. I will point out that the noodles bin is running low. Shirley keeps me apprised of the noodles. If you have some noodles, or if you have $5 or $10 or something, stick it in an envelope so that we have plenty of noodles for the next carryout. W2W was off last week. We're back this week. So that's what we have going on. please continue. If you haven't, I know probably most of you have, but if you haven't, take a look at the renovations that have gone on around the building, especially this front corner up here that was in the process. Tom, Tony, Jason, it was in the process of falling off. Tom's back from his vacation. We're glad to have you back. The whole process has gone on this entire time. We've still got some little things to do, but they were all things that we needed to do. If you want to make a contribution to the building fund, please designate your check as such so that we can keep all of this in front of us and paid for. Are there any other announcements? All right. Sally? Oh, I'm sorry. Let's go shake.
If you please stand, we'll have our invocation. Dear loving God, on this first Sunday of November, we come with grateful hearts, praising your name in word and song, as witnessed by those here, gathered together in the comfort of this sanctuary, and by those worshiping in the midst, in the comfort of their own homes, or worshiping throughout the week on live stream. What a wonderful outreach tool to reach out and bring the worship service to others near and far. For this is the day that the Lord has made. Today and every day, we rejoice and are glad in it. Look around and we witness the everyday turmoil in the world. Our faith for a brighter tomorrow shines brightly. For when we close our eyes, we envision your peace that passeth all understanding. That peace has a place in our heart, for you, O God, have planted it there. It is mankind's choice to cultivate it by opening our eyes to the needs of the world and filling our hearts with concern for all people, locally and globally. As we pray the Lord's Prayer together, let us envision that peace that passes all understanding. Let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. if you would remain standing, we'll have our hymn of praise, which is hymn number 4. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. We will sing verses 1, 2, and 4 of hymn number 4.
Would you please be seated? Is everything working okay now? Is everything working okay? We had a problem with the sound in the building, obviously, because it probably sounded like we were whispering up here. Hopefully we got that straightened out. Shirley. Jane Rose.
Good morning. How are you today with your unicorn dress on? You doing good? Okay, I want you to imagine something. I want you to pretend for a minute. I understand that you go to school on Fridays and you're in a classroom. Is there a teacher at the front and desks with students in the back? I have a picture of a teacher in the front and students in the back. Okay, I want you to pretend for a minute that you're one of the students in class, okay? And you have a teacher up in front. Okay, now, I don't know if you really like your teacher, but I want you to pretend that you just love that teacher. You think she's the best teacher in the world, and you would do anything for her because you really, really like your teacher, okay? Can you pretend that for a minute? Okay, now the teacher's up in front and she says, I have a really important job that I need someone to do. Could I have a volunteer to do this job for me? And Jane Rose raises her hand and she says, I'll do it, I'll do it, I'll go, I'll do it. I can't really see you doing that, but we're going to pretend like you do that. I'll do it, I'll do it, I'll go. Do you think you might do that someday? Maybe? Okay, well, we're going to pretend like you did that. Okay, I told you that, and I wanted you to pretend like that was you because I wanted to tell you another story out of the Bible that we're going to hear Phil talk about today. There was a man, Isaiah, and Isaiah did something that no one in this room has ever got to do. Isaiah saw God. Nobody else has seen God. But he saw God, and God was sitting up on this, up real high on a pedestal, on a throne. Just like the teachers up in front of the class, well, God was up on this big throne, and he had on a big fancy robe, and there were angels flying around God, and the angels, they had wings, and they had to cover their eyes because they couldn't look at God, but Isaiah saw all of this, and then God spoke to Isaiah, and he said, I need someone to go do a really important job for me. Who can I send? Who can do this? And Isaiah raised his hand and said, I'll go, I'll do it, I'll go. And so God let Isaiah go, and he had a message to speak to his people, and Isaiah did it. Now, you know what? We're supposed to be like Isaiah, and we're supposed to be like Jane Rose in that first story I told, and we're supposed to say, I'll do it, I'll go, and we're supposed to do whatever God wants us to do. How do we know what God wants us to do? We don't see God like Isaiah, but we hear God speaking in our heart. Do you have a heart up there? We hear God in our heart talking to us, and we need to always be listening for God. So when God wants us to do something, that we can raise our hand and say, I'll go, God. I'll do it, God. You know, it might be things like working on our building, or it might be things like helping your mom pick up some trash in the back, or it may be jobs like handing out the bulletins. It could be all kinds of jobs, but sometimes God needs us to do things. Sometimes God needs us to speak and tell people about how Jesus loves us. And we need to always be willing to listen and do what God wants us to do. Okay, you think you can do that? Think we can all do that? All right, well, let's try. Okay, let's have a word of prayer. Thank you, God, for letting us learn how you speak to us and how that you always need us to do things for you. Help us to listen and be willing to say, I'll go, I'll send me, because I will do whatever you need me to do. Help us to always be willing to tell other people about you and your love. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
So we prepare our hearts and minds for prayer and for the birthdays, which we have a change. Sally's going to take care of the birthdays, since I typically forget them. We don't want that to keep happening. Let's turn to 609, Take My Life and Let It Be, numbers 1, 5, and 6, 609.
I have a few birthdays to announce today, but first we want to say happy birthday to Barb. Barb wasn't here on her birthday, Barb Finfrock. Her birthday was October the 19th. And we're going to sing happy birthday to you in just a minute. First, Aliana LeGrand has a birthday on November the, she had a birthday on November the 1st, and Barbara Kinman has a birthday on November the 7th. But since Barb is here, we will sing happy birthday. We missed that on October the 19th, so we'll sing to you now.
And we'll sing every Sunday you come. We've been trying since October the 19th to get that done. All right, prayer list. Finally, everything seems to be working. Michelle McGahey, this is Jim and Janet's daughter-in-law. I haven't had an update, but we want to continue to remember her. Denny Batts, Bob put them on. Thad Hamilton. Thad is the gentleman that comes and sits with Bobby from time to time. He is the grandson of Herb Tinsley, who is one of the former ministers of our church. and he is in the hospital. He took a fall. Also, we want to add the family of Herman Main. Herman died in a motorcycle accident. Is that right, Tom? Died in a motorcycle accident. Glad you're back again from Aruba, and hope you had a good time. Any others? Tony? If anybody wants to donate to the Thanksgiving dinners, it's just amazing, isn't it, how the holidays slip up on you? It seems like they've come forever, then all at once you got a two-week deadline, and you got to get it done. So if you'd like to contribute to that. Any other announcements or any other things that we need to add to the prayer list?
I'd like to ask if everybody could just take a moment and say a prayer. She's a third grader. Her name is Ella Kinkle. And she is in a hospital in St. Louis. She was at recess Thursday on the swing, and a little boy was playing football, and they collided. And she now has a brain bleed. They're not sure if she's going to live. Her family is connected with my sister's family, and she asked if we would have special prayer for her.
Okay. Certainly. Any others? Good to see everyone out again this morning. Let's pause for a moment of quiet meditation. Our Father God, as we hear the great anthem that touches our scripture today, hear my Lord. We know that you are calling us to do various things in our lives and in the community. The theme is that we want to be aware of that call, how we respond. Thing is, we don't live in a vacuum. We live with other people. We live in other situations. There are those who need us just as we need them. Help us to be responsive, oh God. That's what a big part of being a Christian is. To be responsive to the needs of others. Not to be judgmental. Not to say, well, if you do it this way or that way, I'll help you. Not to try to direct their lives, but to respond to the needs as we see those needs and as they share them. We come together today in this place, O God, and we thank you for all that you are doing here in our church, in our community. We look for ways that we can continue to reach out. We discussed today in our Sunday school class that how things have changed across the years. How the focus of what churches do, how they do it, how they go about their rubrics of the worship service, whatever it is, have changed. What hasn't changed, or what should never change, is how we reach out and how we offer up ourselves to say, here am I, Lord, send me. We ask your blessings upon us today, O God. We ask your blessings upon those whose names we've mentioned here in the prayer list, the little girl who is teetering with death-defying injury, the family that's lost a loved one, whatever the reason may be, those who are upon beds of illness. And we too continue, O God, to ask globally that you bring some semblance of sense to this mess in the Middle East, that these folks, all people of God, your people, cannot manage to agree on much of anything. They never have, but hopefully they can, to avoid senseless bloodshed, pain, and suffering. We come to you today on this beautiful day. We thank you for that. We give you the praise, and we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Last week, Diana Bradley sang Dropkick Me, Jesus, Through the Goalpost of Life. It was a hit around the world, I think. It was a great song and a great message. So, what's your encore?
I don't think I can ever cap that song. It was very appropriate for the theme of the sermon that day. But today's sermon theme is to sharpen our pencils and listen to God's love. Well, this song is about when God writes his love in our heart. I have sung it before, but it is upbeat, so I hope you enjoy it. When God dips his pen of love in my heart, and he writes my soul a message he wants me to know, his spirit all divine fills this sinful soul of mine. When God dips his love in my heart, well, I said I wouldn't tell it to a living soul how he brought salvation and he made me whole. Found I couldn't hide such a love as Jesus did impart. He makes me laugh and he makes me cry, sets my sinful soul on fire. When God dips his love in my heart. Sometimes, though the way is dreary, dark, and cold, and some unburdened sorrow keeps me from my goal, I go to God in prayer. I can always find him there to whisper sweet peace to my soul. Well, said I wouldn't tell it to a living soul how he brought salvation and he made me whole. Found I couldn't hide such a love as Jesus did impart. He makes me laugh and he makes me cry, sets my sinful soul on fire. When God dips his love in my heart. He walked every step of Calvary's rugged way and gave his life completely to bring a better day. My life was steeped in sin, but his love he took me in. His blood washed away every stain. Well, said I wouldn't tell it to a living soul how he brought salvation and he made me whole. Found I couldn't hide such a love as Jesus did impart. He makes me laugh and he makes me cry, sets my sinful soul on fire. When God wrote his love in my heart.
Next message. Nice message. I want to say the challenges that we have experienced this morning with our audiovisual program, they aren't unique to us. I was watching a football game or a movie or something the other day, and all at once all the characters are just frozen. You know, you sit there and you think, well, what's going to happen? And I think, here's an operation, it's a multi-million-dollar broadcasting operation that nonetheless relies on a live stream. And somewhere, once it leaves all of our equipment here and everything, it's got to float around and it comes down somewhere else. And sometimes it faces challenges. So all of you that are working to make this work, our thanks to you. I don't even know how to turn it on anymore. When I first came, I didn't know how to turn on the sound box, and that's all we had. But now it's a way that we reach out to others. The pencils need sharpening. This is a story that comes from several years ago, actually, and in all truth and honesty about it, full disclosure, as we have to have these days, from another congregation that I served. And after the church service, people had put their contributions in the offering plate when we passed them instead of sitting it on the back table. An offering envelope or building fund or visitor's card or something said, all it said was, the pencils need sharpening. In the offering plate, the pencils need sharpening. I thought, I wish I could get a hold of that person. I would like to know, if they need sharpening, why can't you say, as Shirley pointed out to Jane Rose today, why can't you hold up your hand and say, the pencils need sharpening, and I'll sharpen it. I'll sharpen them. I'll take care of that. The theme of this is, you don't have any idea where the suggestion comes from, but the message is there's something here that needs to be done, and someone needs to do it. There's a problem that we're facing, someone needs to deal with, but we don't have anyone here at Warsaw. We didn't have anyone at the church that I was serving at that time that was particularly designated sharpen pencils. That it wasn't their job to sharpen the pencils. But the pencils needed to be sharpening. They needed to be sharpened. Do you see the message there? If there's something that needs to be done, we need to do it. If you're walking down the street and you see a piece of trash that doesn't look like it's contaminated with some foul something or other, something that's in the street, do you stop long enough to pick it up and perhaps put it in a receptacle, or you say, that's not my job? I didn't put that there. Someone needs to do that. Someone needs to pick that up. In another sort of related story, once many, many years ago when I lived just a mile and a half from the church instead of 50, I always said to the church, look, this was before the days of live stream and all of these modern conveniences. I had a big four-wheel drive Ford Bronco. Some of you people that know anything about trucks will know that that was a awesome vehicle, and it was very little that could keep that in. And I said, if I can get there in my Ford Bronco, we'll have church. So just count on it. We'll be there. And if you need a ride and you're nearby, let me know. I'll pick you up, and we'll have church. We had a pretty good snow. I mean, it was significant, and most people couldn't get out in a normal vehicle. There was one lady that lived at the bottom of the hill, very active in the church. And she calls me up, and she says, are we going to have church this morning? I said, yes, I said we were. We're going to have church. I said, can I pick you up? She said, oh, no, I'm not going. I just want to know if we're going to have it. I wanted to go down there and wreak havoc on the house. Why even? If you're not going, if it's your responsibility, if you're saying, okay, I could, I'm offering, how do we take the responsibilities that are presented to us and use them for a way that we can give back? This passage of Scripture that we visited often this morning, it's from the 8th chapter of the Gospel, the 6th chapter, rather, Gospel of Isaiah. Just one verse that's in this, surrounded in this chapter, is who's going to do what for the Lord? Who's going to volunteer? Who's going to say the word that they will do it? And this is it, this 8th verse of the 6th chapter of Isaiah. And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And whom will go for us? Then I said, here am I, send me. Here am I, send me. I'll do it. I'll do it. I don't know what I'm going to get out of it. I don't care what I'm going to get out of it. It's something that needs to be done. And the Lord was calling for volunteers. Around this has got nothing to do with picking up trash or sharpening pencils. But the message is the same. Here am I, Lord, say to me. We have a good spirit of that here. People volunteer for things, do things. Things get done. Things are getting done around here now. We look at this building and we say, well, we could sell it to somebody and they could make a pizzeria out of it, maybe, or whatever. And we could go out and get us a few acres on the edge of town, build a new church. We wouldn't have all these troubles. But as Tom points out, if we all know, this is a treasure. This is an architectural treasure that we have, and we have committed ourselves to the responsibility. That's what this passage is calling. Commit yourself to the responsibility to do things that are important to be done. What do you do when you hear when God says, or when you feel that tugging in your heart that there's something that needs to be done? Something I need to step up and do. Something that I have the talents to do that. The first choice, I think, is to agree with the great American satirist and writer, Mark Twain, Samuel Clemens. He was full of great stories, and he was full of great one-liners, two-liners, too. One of the things that he once said about exercise was that whenever I get the urge to exercise, I lie down until it goes away. Isn't that deep? Don't you like that? When I get the urge to exercise, I lie down until it goes away. Well, that's kind of sometimes how we are when we hear the call of God. Was that really God? Was that indigestion? Was it something that was confusing? Maybe I thought he was calling me, but, you know, I don't know. Maybe I think he's really calling Sally. She could do a better job at that than I can. Diana can sing a lot better than I can. Nobody ever asked me to sing a solo at church. And don't, please, because Tony and I, maybe a duet sometime. I think we've talked about it, and we've kind of put it off until a better day when we've both been better tuned. We know what our gifts are, folks. We know what they are. How do we use them to the glory of God, to the good of our fellow sojourners? I just completed one of the book that I read. It was just a novel. It's a murder mystery. I like to read murder mysteries. All the deep theology stuff I have to read, I like to read those too. And the guy was really philosophical in this, and he was talking about what's life about? What's the purpose? What are we here to do? Why are we here to do it? Well, that's the purpose, is to find the purpose. How do we live in relation to one another? How did we end up here in relationships with one another? How did we get here? What is our responsibility? And our responsibility is the same question that the prophet, our God, asked the prophet. What am I supposed to do? Here am I, send me. Learn what it is. Find out what it is. Do something that helps other people. Okay, if you're not going to lie down and let the thought go away, what's next? Hope is one that's next. Assume somebody else is going to do it. I always like that one. You know, I could do that, but maybe if I just hope, someone else will come along and do it. Someone else will hear the same call that I did, and they will come along and provide the answer. They heard the same message that I did. They heard the same call. They'll answer it. I know they will. And so you just kind of slink around and so that nobody sees you. You move on out of the picture. You think someone else will come in. Someone else will answer this. It's probably not the best idea to assume that. But we often aren't the first person that steps up and says, here am I, send me. When was the last time that you heard of a volunteer opportunity and you volunteered first? You were the first one in line. Once many, many years ago when our kids were little and they were making a pitch at the elementary school for someone to head up the Cub Scout program. Or maybe it was the Boy Scouts, I don't know. But it was like an evangelistic preacher that came from the Boy Scouts. And I felt so bad. We've talked about that here, Spike, a lot about the Scouts. I felt so bad, I nearly volunteered to be a scout leader. because the guy was just pulling at my heartstrings. These boys won't be the same. Life won't be complete unless they're Boy Scouts. You've just got to do this for your children. You've got to do it. I thought, well, I flunked out of the Weeblos in the Cub Scouts. I got my Wolf, Bear, and Lion badges, but I flunked out after that. I'm not a very good scout, but I'm willing to try because of this impassioned call. Because the guy was more or less saying, if it's not you, who? If it's not now, when? Who is going to go? Who's going to go do this for us? You see, it would be really something interesting if we could step up. Say, I'll take care of that. I'll do it. I volunteer. Third, just do it. Just step up and say, here am I, Lord. Here am I. Send me. Whatever it is in your life, you can sit there right now and think about it. Think, well, I don't know. I don't want to do anything in church. I do enough as it is. Tom put all this, lot this together with Tony and Jason. He headed off for vacation for 2 weeks. Poor old Tony. Tony called me 3 times a day, text me, and asked me something, tell me what's going on here at the church. And he was in and out all the time. I said last week, Tony is the general contractor on this project. He was running back and forth to Means to get the, they needed this, they needed that. There were things that needed to be done over at the parsonage that have needed to be done for some time. And I was hounding Tony about that. I'm sure, Molly, he was probably saying bad things about what Phil, we give him that house to stay in when he's here. Why doesn't he, what's he worried about the toilet flushing? Why would that be any concern for him, you know? What about if the shower doesn't work? They got the shower fixed one day. Tony said, half of it's fixed. I went up and turned it on. It was cold water. I said, well, they fixed the wrong half. We fixed that. Then we had to end up having a hot water heater because the hot water heater was ruined because of our hard water. Tony took care of this. He stepped up and said, here am I. I'll do it. Once upon another time when I was called to a church many, many, many years ago, the guys on the pulpit committee, I didn't see them for the first 6 weeks that I was there after I accepted the position. And I said, well, they finally came. I said, what happened to you guys? I said, I thought you were involved in the work of the church. I thought you were. They said, we've been around and heard so many guys talk. So many, this was before the days of many women in the pulpit. We've heard so many talk, so many sermons. We're just tired. So we're just taking the time off. We're just going to take a break from it. I said, well, that makes sense. What do you do? Here am I, said me. You say, are there dull pencils in the back of these pews? Seen any? If there are, here's the answer to the question. Who will sharpen the pencils? To paraphrase Isaiah, you say, here am I. Give me those pencils. Whatever it is, I'll sharpen them. That's what we need to focus on, how we need to focus to live our lives, to help others, to help God in His work. May we bow together in prayer. Our Father God, on this beautiful sunny day, we thank You for everything that You've done for us, everything that You continue to do. If it's something as simple as sharpening pencils, let us say yes. If it's something more complicated, let us say, yes, I'll try and I'll work with others. Whatever it may be, oh God, we've just got to step up and say, here am I, send me. I'll do it. I'll try. I want to help. Because the kingdom of God does not advance with just the words in the book. It advances on our backs. Bless us as we live our lives. Bless us as we work together. Bless us as we try to make sense of things that don't make any sense. And help us to forever be turning to You through Your Son, Jesus Christ. In His name we ask it. Amen. Our hymn of invitation this morning and our hymn to the Lord's table is this. Called as Partners in Christ's Service. The hymn is number 433 and we'll sing the first and second verses. 453. 453, first and second verses. Would you please stand?
We come to the time where we gather around the Lord's table. This is the Lord's table, and it's open to all believers. If you believe in Jesus in your heart, this invitation is open to you, everyone here and everyone viewing it, worshiping at home, worshiping on live stream. As we prepare our hearts and minds for communion, let us pray. Dear loving God, please be with us this morning. Please be with us each and every day of the week. And be with us this morning as we share this communion together. Let it be food for our souls, food for our bodies, and in turn, our service to you is our gift to you. For you have given us a gift of Jesus. We remember Jesus' many great sacrifices at this time that we gather around the table. And in all our prayers, we pray that thy will be done. In Jesus' name, amen. And on that night when they gathered in the upper room, they were gathered for what they thought was the Passover. Jesus and his disciples thought this was the Passover meal. But yet this became the Lord's Last Supper. He took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it. And he passed it among his disciples saying, "Take, eat, for this is my body, which is broken for you." Let us take the bread of heaven together and remember Jesus' many great sacrifices.
And in a like manner, he took the cup, passed it among them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you, for this is the blood of the new covenant. For as often as you eat of the bread and drink of the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Let us drink from the cup of forgiveness. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, you have blessed us with this gift of life. Touch us deeply with your gift of forgiveness. Let your healing touch through the bread and cup heal our broken spirit up into your healing grace. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And for the benediction, and remember, we're trying for all of us to say amen at the end so that we're participating. Our Father God, we thank you for a beautiful day. We thank you for a great verse from Isaiah. We hope that we've done it justice, that we understand that when you call, our responsibility is to say, "Here am I, send me." And it is in the name of your Son that we all say together, amen.